What up, it's your boy T-Bird here in the reaction. So, I decided I'm going to do a kill count for y'all. Since the last one's pretty short, I'm going to do this for y'all. Y'all might finally get your wish, I might finally lose one. I'm trying to look away. So, I'm going to start doing the kill count for the Star Wars series, and it's kicking it off with the very first song that came out in 2004. I'm not ready for this. I'm really not ready for this, but whew. Let's do this. Since this is the actual version, I won't be doing Citizen Renounce. This is not from Dead Meat or anything. So no, it's not from Dead Meat's Patreon. This is actual from the Dead Meat's YouTube channel. So here we go. Let's get it.
The kill count is owned entirely by the copyright holders. Dead Meat makes no claim of ownership and simply uses the footage for purposes of education, commentary, and criticism under fair use. Please support filmmakers and the art of filmmaking by watching Saw on home media or streaming services where available.
This must been me go back because I want to do my little dance with it. This must be when because Brandy Rashad had to throw his and that's when also when I started putting the fair use thing because YouTube is going crazy. So anyway, let's get it.
Commentary and criticism under fair use. Please support filmmakers and the art of filmmaking by watching Saw on home media or streaming services where available. Welcome to the Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies. I'm James H. Denise, and today looking at Saw, a low-budget film with a big impact, released in 2004. Directed by James Wan and written by Lee Whannell, Saw is one of the most influential horror films ever made, injecting life and brutality into a genre that had grown stagnant with Scream knockoffs aimed at teenagers. It was so successful, it would go on to spawn 6 sequels released on an annual basis throughout the rest of the decade, with an 8th film, Jigsaw, hitting theaters last year, and a 9th movie all but confirmed at this point. Saw's reputation precedes it, although it's often dismissed as
one play games, motherfucker?
This first film is no more graphic than your standard sleazy slasher. Sure, the sequels would get bloodier and bloodier, but the original Saw is more about the mystery of the Jigsaw Killer, and of course, the traps that forces victims to make difficult decisions if they want to come out alive. The original also sets up the twisted storytelling and flashbacks within flashbacks that would give this series one of the most convoluted running storylines in all of horror. Over the next 8 weeks, I'll guide hardcore fans and the uninitiated alike through all of this madness. But right now, let's start at the beginning and get to the kills. The movie begins with a blue light surrounded by darkness. The light's attached to something floating in a tub of water, and when this dude wakes up in it, the light goes straight down the drain. Later, we'll learn how much that sucks. Bathtub boy calls out, confused in the darkness, and is greeted by a very gravelly voice.
Turn the lights!
What if I could?
When the lights do come on, they blind this guy like it's 3 in the morning and he had to get up and take a pee. He's in a bathroom, and across from him is the gravel-voiced gentleman. Between them is a body, lying in a big pool of blood from an apparent self-inflicted gun wound to the head. In one hand, the gun. In the other, a tape recorder. And both the living men find their ankles chained to the bathroom pipes. A lot of us have seen this movie 1,000 times, but I always try to remember that this setup is instantly intriguing, and also probably helped start the escape room craze that I love so much. Our bathtub boy is Adam, played by screenwriter Lee Whannell. Damn, this dude can write and act?
What's your name?
My name is very fucking confused. What's your name?
Well, at least he can write. The other guy is Cary Elwes, trying real hard to hide his English accent. His character's name?
He is Lawrence Gordon. I'm a doctor.
He's a doctor, and he too just woke up in this place. Neither of them can remember getting there at all.
I went to bed in my shithole apartment and woke up in an actual shithole.
And this place is a shithole. Look at it. There's shit all over the walls. There's shit everywhere. Gordon realizes that the wall clock isn't covered in shit, so it must be new and placed there with a purpose, like a time-telling purpose. In his pants, Adam finds an envelope with his name on it, and inside is a very pushy tape. We'll play you when we get the time tape. Gordon's pants are home to another self-promoting tape, but with an additional bonus bullet. Oh shit, there's a key in there too? But as us escape room aficionados could have guessed, the key doesn't work in any of the locks they have right now. That tape recorder would sure be handy though, and through the power of plaid and a bathtub chain, Adam's able to reach the dead body and retrieve the dead media device. The tape he plays gives the world its first listen to Jigsaw.
Rise and shine, Adam. You're probably wondering where you are. I'll tell you where you might be. You might be in the room that you die in.
The tape calls Adam a voyeur and says now he has the chance to act instead of just watch. Pretty cryptic, and definitely not the tape you'd want to take to a desert island. Hoping to hear a better pop, Gordon tosses his tape to Adam. DJ Tubboy plays that track, and the tape gives Gordon some instructions.
Your aim in this game is to kill Adam. You have until 6 on the clock to do it.
It also spills a bunch of other info, like how the dude in the room shot himself because he was super poisoned, that X marks the spot for treasure, and that if he doesn't kill Adam by 6, then Gordon's wife and daughter will die. He'll be left in this room to rot.
Let the game begin.
Oh. Could we do Catan instead? A closer listen reveals a very faint whisper saying, "Follow your heart." And looks like there's a shitty heart shit painted on that shitty toilet tank. Adam plugs his nose and fishes inside the bowl, only to find nothing, and checks in the tank like any reasonable person would have done first. He finds a plastic bag with 2 hacksaws inside. And maybe that's it. Or maybe Adam is tossing the bag aside discreetly for a specific reason. When the saws do nothing against their chains, Adam throws his against the wall in rage, where it breaks off a piece of shit-covered mirror. Seems like those saws might prefer the taste of flesh.
He doesn't want us to cut through our chains. He wants us to cut through our feet.
That's what I'm saying, Gordy. Gordon says he knows who's doing this to them, and we launch into our first flashback of the series. Get ready for confusing time jumps, because this franchise plays with chronology as much as frickin' Lost does. Oh, speaking of Lost, one of the detectives on the case is Steven Sink, played by Ken Leong. His partner is David Tapp, played by Danny Glover, and they just found themselves a corpse strung up in razor wire. Detective Allison Carey, Dina Meyer of Starship Troopers, tells them how this dude had a real rough death
crawling through the mess,
and then they found a tape on the scene.
Hello, Paul. You are a perfectly healthy, sane, middle-class male. Yet last month, you ran a straight razor across your wrist.
See, now here's our first glimpse at Jigsaw's mentality. Middle-class male Paul here was apparently cutting himself, and rather than sympathetically ask what's wrong, Jigsaw sticks him in a room full of razor wire and says if he wants to live, he's gotta escape before the door locks at 3 o'clock. We see Paul's death played out as he tries to win Jigsaw's game, scene edited like an industrial music video. It looks a little silly now, but it was a creative solution to the film's low quality and lack of coverage, so I ain't gonna hate. Paul's body is missing a piece of flesh, cut out in the shape of a puzzle piece, and thus the name of our condescending killer is born.
Actually, technically speaking, he's not really a murderer.
Ugh, this shit. There's sometimes this idea that Jigsaw technically isn't a killer, since he just finds ways for his victims to kill themselves. Yeah, hey Jigsaw, maybe ask Charlie Manson how that shit holds up in court. Oh wait, you can't, he died in prison. The detectives find another body, this dude Mark, who was apparently, I don't know, fraudulently using a handicap parking sticker or something. Jigsaw poisoned him and put the antidote inside a safe, a combination of which is written on the walls somewhere among all these numbers. But wait, there's also tons of glass on the floor. But wait again, he's smeared down in some flammable jelly, so the candle he's using to light his way could become fatal. And it does.
Oh!
After trying to win this impossible fucking game. But, you know, technically Jigsaw didn't kill him, the trap did. Yeah, well, who put him in the trap?
Wow.
Jigsaw did. Carrie points out a peephole and says Jigsaw likes to have a front row seat to his own games. She also finds a penlight on the scene that belongs to Dr. Gordon. Remember, we're still in a flashback, and in it, Gordon is talking about a patient with an inoperable tumor. He keeps calling the dude the patient, which I feel is pretty standard, but someone's not a fan of that clinical speech.
His name is John, Dr. Gordon.
Hey, speaking of Lost, it's Michael Emerson playing Zep, an orderly at the hospital who says the patient John is actually a very interesting person. Gordon's lesson is interrupted by the school principal calling him to the office, and as he leaves, one of his students leers at him with some serious fuck me eyes. Tap and Sing are waiting for him to return the penlight and take him to the station, but Gordon's cleared after he reluctantly gives them an alibi that we don't get to hear just yet. Must have been something embarrassing, like a bad night of diarrhea. For some reason, Sing has Gordon stick around to eavesdrop on a surviving Jigsaw victim telling her tale. What the hell kind of sloppy police work is that?
Is that the homegirl?
Privacy rights are getting all kinds of violated. The survivor, Amanda, who he might want to remember going forward, relays her story in a flashback replete with more music video style editing. She woke up in a room with the most infamous trap of the series fixed around her head. A reverse bear trap, as explained to her by Billy the Puppet in his premiere appearance.
Hello, Amanda. I want to play a game.
The device is jaws, and when the timer runs out, well, this happens. Oh, that poor wig hat. The key to unlock the device is in the stomach of Amanda's supposedly dead cellmate.
That's how she jailed, because I saw the chair and kills.
The timer, it becomes evident that the dude on the ground by her is not in fact dead, but rather very much alive. Still, Amanda came here to win, so she puts it all on the field and grabs the provided knife to carve this dude's stomach open like she stabs him a whole heap load of times, tearing apart his guts and to find his stomach, which has the key inside. She manages to get the trap off just before it turns her head into styrofoam dust, and her victory parade of Billy and his trademark red tricycle comes out of the shadows to congratulate her.
Congratulations. Most people are so ungrateful to be alive, but not you. Not anymore.
Good job, Amanda. You won gratitude? Tap mentions that she was a drug addict, which, again, pretty harsh rehab treatment there, Jigsaw. But I guess in her case, it worked.
He helped me.
Back in the shit bathroom, Adam discovers the mirror glass that broke off is two-way, and when he busts out the remaining glass, they find a camera in the medicine cabinet. Unbeknownst to either bathroom boy, on the other side of the camera is someone watching them with a taunting voice.
I can see you.
Gordon talks about his family for a while and tosses his wallet to Adam so he can see a picture of the Gordon clan. But inside the wallet is a pic you probably wouldn't want to send out with the Christmas cards. On the back of this scary terrorist picture is a reminder that X marks the spot, but with an additional clue saying sometimes you see more with your eyes shut.
That doesn't make sense.
Adam doesn't divulge this information to the doc and instead pockets the scary pic for himself. Another flashback takes us to the last time Gordon saw his family, after his daughter Diana woke up his wife Allison to say there was a bad man in her room. Gordon helped put Diana back to bed by playing Levy Boy's favorite game, This Little Piggy, but right in the middle of wee-wee-weeing, he gets interrupted by his beeper going off. On his way to answer the call, he gets into an argument with Allison in their weird fucking living room. What is that curtain? They have a little stage back there? Maybe they should use it to perform this marital drama they've got going on, since their relationship is obviously on the ropes. Gordon leaves, and back in Diana's room, she sees an eye peeping out of her closet. Her scream brings Allison to the room to find a ghost. Nah, it's not a ghost. It's just a mean-spirited son of a bitch who holds the Gordon family hostage in their own home and plays a sick game where he listens to Diana's heartbeat rise as he holds a gun up to her mom's head. Viewers watching the top of the frame see that this bastard is Zep the Orderly. Is Zep Jigsaw? I don't know. As Zep Saw looks out the window, he's spied upon by someone through a camera. It's Detective Tap, working out of a room with crazy all over the walls and growling about Gordon.
I never should have let you go.
Heads up, this is now the present, but you'd be forgiven if you didn't know, since these flashbacks forget to announce themselves half the time. To maybe try to help with the confusion, the movie has a minute-long recap montage. But you're not even halfway over yet, Saw. This kind of hand-holding will be useful later on when the story gets crazy, but come on, we just watched all this shit. At least the montage gives us this insane goddamn transition where a car drives in front of a rueful-looking Danny Glover. What the fuck is that? Oh yeah, and now we're back in the past, when Tap let Gordon go after they all shared popcorn watching Amanda's messed up testimony. It must be haunting Tap, since he goes straight back to the station and rewatches the Jigsaw tape over and over again like it's his favorite YouTube channel. You're only helping Jigsaw's ad revenue, Tap. His obsessive rewatching pays off, though, when he hears a fire alarm in the background and notes a gang symbol on a wall. He and Sync check which fire alarms went off within the gang's territory, and voila! They're headed to an abandoned warehouse to get themselves a Jigsaw, not bothering with a warrant or any backup at all. Nothing could go wrong here. Inside the warehouse, they find an open space office that Jigsaw must use as a home base. And a crafting center. Aw, look at his cute little shoebox diorama. He'll definitely get an A on that. He'll also probably pass his kidnapping quiz, because they find a dude there under a red blanket, tied up and captured in a trap. Traptured? When they hear the elevator coming up, Tap wants to hide and pretend they're not there to, I don't know, see what Jigsaw does or something. It doesn't make any sense. Just arrest the guy in the elevator. But instead, they watch from the shadows as Jigsaw, in a snazzy black and red robe, checks on his captive and spouts off his arrogant bullshit.
Don't cry. I've given your life a purpose.
The detectives come out, but having given up the high ground, Jigsaw is able to kickstart the trap and frustrate them by saying the key to unlock it is in this giant ring. Tap calls Jigsaw sick as he tries to arrest him, and Jigsaw's all like, yeah, I'm sick. Sick of your attitude. Just kidding. He's actually sick from cancer. Sing finally gets some sense and shoots the trap to pieces, but that's when Jigsaw uses a hidden sleeve blade to slash Tap's throat and run the hell away. Sing gives chase to Jigsaw and even manages to shoot him in this dingy hallway. Good shot, Sing, but don't forget that Jigsaw is a boob man. By which I mean booby traps, because when Sing steps through some cobwebs, he trips a wire attached to a bunch of ceiling-mounted shotguns that fire down and blow his
head.
It's not super explicit, but it's still a pretty cool kill. Plus, it's finally a character death that we actually care about. Jigsaw gets up and leaves, only a little worse for wear, right as Tap arrives to see Sing dead and get photographed crying out in anguish. He didn't actually get photographed, but the bizarre editing sure makes it a little confusing. It's so damn messy. Present-day Tap speaks raspily from his now-healed throat wound as we're reminded that he's watching Zep, who is still watching Gordon and Adam. Oh yeah, Gordon and Adam. Can we get back to those bathroom boys already and move the story forward instead of back? Thanks. Adam finally decides to act on that photo hint and tells Gordon to turn off the lights. That reveals an X on the wall that didn't show up before because the glow-in-the-dark paint hadn't charged yet. Gordon busts through the
X bar
to find a locked box. And once again, us escape room pros are eagerly raising our hands to say, hey, the key from earlier should open that bad boy up. And it does. Inside is a cell phone, a couple of cigarettes, and a secret note to Gordon. Gordon, saying the cigarettes aren't necessarily poison. At least, not yet. Gordon tries the phone, but it doesn't work because it's only meant to receive calls. And god damn it, what, another flashback? Okay, sure. We're in a parking garage in a scene that looks soap operatic for some reason, when Gordon fails to notice a camera flash to the face. He also fails to notice this red robe clad pig-headed person crawling on the ground towards him. The pighead rushes him, and jump cuts aplenty get us back inside the shit room, where Gordon is questioning how Adam knew to turn off the lights. After some grilling, Adam reveals the wallet picture to Gordon, who's so spooked by it he can't help but yell out in rage.
What are you doing to them, you bastard?
This kind of desperation might just drive a man to murder. And Gordon eyes the note, the bathroom body's blood on the ground, and the cigarette, then puts all the jigsaw pieces together. He dips the cig into the very poisonous blood while Adam isn't looking, but then he turns off the lights and whispers something to Adam that neither Zep nor the audience can hear. When the lights come back on, they stage a little play, wherein Gordon offers Adam a smoke but gives him the unpoisoned cigarette instead. Adam smokes it and gives a very poor performance of a man being poisoned to death, so unconvincing that he gets heckled in the form of a shock through the ankle chain that makes him break kayfabe. Good plan though, Gordy. The shock apparently zaps some memory back into Adam's brain.
I remember everything now.
Cue another flashback where Adam gets home to his crappy apartment and into his homemade darkroom to develop pictures of, wait for it, Dr. Lawrence goddamn Gordon. Later on, after a darkroom nap, Adam wakes up to find all the lights in his apartment are off, which leads to perhaps the best constructed scene of the movie. Adam stalks around the darkened apartment, intermittently using his camera flash to get snapshots of visibility. It's nice and creepy, especially when the silence is broken by this. That laugh belongs to Bill E. Puppet, who's lounging on a lazy boy. Adam takes a bat to Billy and beats that puppet! He should probably be more concerned about the pig head in the closet. Oh. That's how Adam wound up in the shit room. Gordon gets a call on the cell phone from his tearful daughter saying, yo, you fucked up not getting that bad man out my room, Pops. Allison takes the line next and tells Gordon that Adam lied to him and knows him. But then the line goes dead. Gordon demands to know who Adam is, and he responds sounding like a real guilty little boy.
You know who I am.
That line delivery is the scariest thing in the movie so far. In response to being called a liar, Adam throws it back at Gordon and says, no, you. And we flash back again to that soap opera parking garage where we see Adam is responsible for the earlier scene face flash. Cool. Then we see what else was in that plastic bag from the toilet tank. Adam's pictures of Gordon that he's been collecting for days since he gets paid to track rich dudes having affairs. Affairs like the one Gordon almost had with that thirsty grad student in a steamy hotel room. That's right, I said almost, since he stops it before anything happens. When he leaves, he goes, oh my god, back to that parking garage for the third time in like 10 minutes? Yeah, so we know, there's a camera flash. Gordon questions Adam about who paid him to take pictures, and it turns out to be none other than Detective David Tapp. Damn, Tapp, aren't you getting too old for this shit? Gordon tells Adam all about Tapp in another montage wherein Cary Elwes kind of slips into his English accent when he says the word murders.
He convinced himself that I must have somehow been involved with the murders.
Haha, that's fun. We're having fun here. Right, guys? Adam sees a picture he didn't take and shows it to Gordon, who recognizes the person looking out a dirty old window. It's a Zep in that picture, y'all. Whoa. Gordon starts yelling about how he's gonna pop that little pipsqueak. But time's up, Gordo. It's 6 o'clock and looks to me like Adam is still alive. Luckily, Allison is able to discreetly escape her ties before Zep comes in to kill her. And when he calls Gordon up to tell him the bad news, Allison fights back and wrestles with Zep over his gun. A few shots go off, which alerts Tapp across the street that shit's going down. Then Allison subdues Zep with some scissors to the leg. Tapp breaks into the apartment and gets in a shootout with Zep, during which Allison and Diana escape from the house and the series. Zep smashes a vase over Tapp's head and runs off, saying he's gotta go run some errands and kill Dr. Gordon. Tapp recovers and chases him in the absolute worst car chase I've ever seen in a movie. It's just crazily edited shots of the two of them driving. Wow, this is real bad. Gordon doesn't realize his family got away because all he hears is OK Corral going down over the phone. So in order to escape and save them, he ties a shirt tourniquet around his leg, shirtiquet, and prepares to earn this movie its name. While there are a couple shots of him imagination and show
him horrified
Adam and a crazed Dr. Gordon. The end result, he's done. Meanwhile, Tapas chases Zep down into some tunnels and manages to get him up against the wall. But Zep escapes by slinking down and shooting Tapp, catching him in the chest and surprisingly killing him. This really is the end for Detective Tapp, who falls to the floor dead. Unsurprisingly, Danny Glover would be one of the few actors in the series who never returned for even so much as a flashback. Lawrence crawls his way over to the bathroom body and takes its gun, which he loads with Chekhov's bullet from the beginning of the movie. He's pale as a ghost as he apologetically tells Adam that he's gotta do what he's gotta do.
You have to die.
No, I wanna live! I wanna live!
Sorry.
He shoots his bathroom buddy to the ground and cries out that, come on, he did it, let him go now. But when Zeb shows up to the party, he tells Gordon it's too late. Them's the rules. He goes to shoot Gordon, but gets tripped to the ground by a still-living Adam, who realizes that fists are too good for Zebby Boy. So he grabs the toilet tank lid and beats Zeb's head with a bloody pulp with it. Ooh. Once again, it's not that explicit, the entire thing being shown through low-angle shots of Adam, but Lee Winnell sells it, and the kill ends nicely with the tank lid breaking. Gordon crawls over to Adam and tries to offer some comfort.
I have to go and get help.
Yeah, if I'm Adam, I'm not convinced this is gonna work. This Bub the Zombie-looking one-footed motherfucker is supposed to be his salvation? Color me skeptical. Or color me cynical. I don't care, just color me something so I don't look like this Dr. Gordon ghoul. He crawls out, promising to bring someone back to help him, but Adam wisely starts looking for his own rescue in the form of a key on Zep's body. Instead, he finds a tape player, revealing that Zep is not the evil mastermind of this movie. He's merely been a pawn this whole time.
Hello, Mr. Handel, or as they called you around the hospital, Zep.
The tape reveals Zep was poisoned by Jigsaw and could only earn the antidote by kidnapping the Gordon family and killing them if Lawrence failed. This is an amazing twist if you didn't know it was coming, and I'll forever remember seeing this the first time.
Here we go.
My freaking mind blown. Adam's freaking mind is blown too, and as he sits there in astonishment, we get another great image, that of the bathroom body slowly waking up from its 8-hour nap and getting in a well-deserved cast stretch. This is John Kramer, the man we saw in Gordon's hospital bed, and he is the real Jigsaw killer, the mastermind behind everything we've seen so far. He tells Adam how he was supposed to escape all along.
Key to that chain is in the bathtub.
But that's pretty shitty, John. Adam didn't even have a chance to retrieve that thing. After a crazy quick montage showing many of this movie's moments, Jigsaw turns off the lights and delivers the most amazing final
Game
words
over.
Of a horror movie I've ever seen.
Game over.
Fuck yes. Adam was left screaming in the dark, but he doesn't go on this kill count. You're just gonna have to trust me during this series. Plenty of other people did wind up on the count, though, so let's see how many at the numbers.
Damn. Here we go.
Six people died in Saw, and because Amanda was able to escape her trap, all the victims were male, so we're kicking off this series with the blueberry pie right there. With a runtime of 103 minutes, we got a kill on average every 17.12 minutes, which is a little slow, but this game.
So I remember we got a golden chainsaw.
I'll give the golden chainsaw for coolest kill to Zep. It doesn't happen on screen like a lot of the gore here, but it's still effective because of Adam's unbridled rage. Plus, killing someone with a toilet tank lid is good stuff no matter how it's done. Doll machete for lamest kill definitely goes to Tap. A single slug to the chest is no way for Roger Murtaugh to go out. And guess what? For the Saw series kill counts, I'm proud to announce two new awards that I'll be handing out each episode. The platinum punji sticks will go to the coolest trap in each movie, regardless of if they killed anyone or not. And the inaugural winner will of course be the reverse bear trap that Amanda escaped. Despite not getting to see its end result, this trap is so violent that you even kind of feel for the mannequin head that gets destroyed during the demo. Conversely, the rusty mouse trap goes to the movie's lamest trap. I'll give this one to Adam's bathroom trap, because like what? His whole game was to just not let the key go down the drain when he woke up? And that's it. Saw came out in 2004 and changed the horror genre forever. Not everything about it holds up 14 years later, but it still deserves recognition for how influential it was. I'll take a look at the first sequel, Saw 2, next week, but until then, I'm James A. Janisse. This has been The Kill Count. Thanks a lot for watching today's Kill Count.
Alright, so, surprisingly I made it through. Probably because I heard that this wasn't like, out of all the Saws, this was like the least gory one. So, I'm in for a surprise. I did actually watch 2. I don't really want to rewatch 3, but I'm going to have to for this kill count. But I did watch 2, which is not all crazy. Now, it's gory, but not all as crazy as 3 is, and later on. So, yeah. Other than that, here you go. So, if you like my reaction, like, share, subscribe my YouTube channel. Like I said, I'm doing in-between, so next in-between will be the kill counts. In between, and the next one would definitely be the Evil Dead remake that was requested. So I'm starting off with the requested ones y'all wanted me to do, such as Evil Dead remake, and next after that would be Saw 2, then after that would be Slim Party. Then once I do Saw 3, the explicit version, which I will have to do with some censoring. I gotta review the video and do some censoring, so it'll probably be a while to come out. And it might be the day I debut my Patreon's one too. So, I'm still trying to figure out how to set that whole Patreon up. So, other than that, and after that, I'll start my new batch, which starts out with Babysitter, which was the highly most voted video. So, other than that, if you like my reaction, like, share, subscribe my YouTube channel. It's your boy T-Bear signing off. One love.